building blocks in place, we could at least recover to some extent. And that is what I think we will probably then finish the year with a no gain, no loss kind of a situation. That's going to be the best case scenario. But I think the worldwide scenario also is important here. As you know, this is not a pandemic that is related to Sri Lanka only. It's a global problem. When it's a global problem, we have to search for a global response as well. Now, if you take an example, it's like you have a flat in an apartment block, and the apartment block is on fire. So whatever you may do, even if you were to go in with a bucket of water, try to douse the fire in your own flat, it's trying to make sure that your strategy is worldwide. There is one worldwide strategy that will take care of the global issues. I think maybe during the course of this discussion, I can deal with those. We need to have a global response, just like what happened after the World War II, where the Bretton Woods institutions were set up, the IMF and the World Bank and so on. At the same time, those two institutions might need to now look at a different approach of this problem. So that's one is the global approach. The other is a regional approach. And when I say regional, not necessarily only a region from the point of view of a geographical region. We are now in an emerging markets block. Now, these emerging markets have a specific kind of a vulnerability that they will have to deal with. So that vulnerability has to be dealt with a regional or an emerging markets kind of approach. And I think that's another area that I would like to see happening, where that is done. Then thirdly, and most importantly, a local approach. Where do our local industries, local services, local agriculture fit in to this entire situation? And do we take action with regard to giving stimulus into each of these areas? Stimulus is not only just money. Stimulus is not only cash or holding back a loan for some time or an infusion of some money to for that area to grow. Stimulus is the entire platform. If people have money in their hands, that itself creates a demand. So even if you give a stimulus to the, I'm giving an example, Nista, even if you give a stimulus to the industries or services, but if the demand is not created with people having money to access that new type of venture, then the whole thing will fail. So I believe this is going to be a tough call, where the challenge will be how we can get this into shape. If any sa api metanedi balannatone kohomada ape rate ape palate ape api ina kshetre rata tiya kshetre api da emerging markets kila kiyana e kshetre ඊට පස්සේ ගෝලීයව අපි කොහොමද මේකට මුහුණ දෙන්නේ අපි හැම තලයකම මේ සටන ගෙන යන්නට ඕන එතකොට අපි හැම තලයකම මේ සටන හරියට කරගෙන ගියා නම් මට පේන හැටියට අර මේ ධම්මික පෙර මහත්මයා කිව්වා වගේ අපි මේක බලන්න ඕනේ මේ සමූහයක් හැටියට කොහොමද මේ මැච් එක ගහන්නේ කියලා හැම ඕවර් එකක්ම වැදගත් ඉතින් හැම බෝල් එකක්ම වැදගත් ඉතින් ඒ විදිහට බලලා එක එක පැතිවලින් අපි ඒකට මේ හරි විදියට ක්‍රීඩා කරන කෙරුවොත් මම හිතන්නේ අපිට මේකට හොඳ උත්තර ලබා ගන්නට පුළුවන් වේවි.
ඔකේ මිස්ටර්. Yeah, thanks Nivad. Dhammika, thank cricket match එක ගැන කතා කරා මම හිතන්නේ අපේ රට සූදානන්ද ඔය ඕවර් 30 නැත්නම් ඕවර් 300 match එකක් ගහන්න මම කියන්නේ මොනවාද අවශ්‍ය
අරින්නේ එතකොට හැම සෙක්ටර් එකකටම මං හිතනවා අපි ඊළඟ මොකද වර්ල්ඩ් එක මූව් වෙලා තියෙන තැනට මූව් වෙන්න වෙයි. නැත්තම් මේ $4,000 එකත් එක්ක මං හිතනවා හරිම අමාරුයි ඒ වගේ හැම සෙක්ටර් එකක්ම උඩට ගන්න. ඒ කියන්නේ අපිට විෂන් එකක් තියෙනවා ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් සෙක්ටර් එකට කොහොමද ෆුඩ් ප්‍රොසෙසින් යන්නේ. දැන් මම හිතන්නේ නිසරත් හොඳ අත්දැකීමක් තියෙනවා ඒ සම්බන්ධව. දැන් ඉන්දියාවේ එහෙම ගත්තොත් ෆුඩ් ප්‍රොසෙසින් වලට 133ක් ග්‍රාන්ට්ස් දෙනවා 100% මේ GST payable එක ගෙවන්න ඕනේ. ඉතින් ඒක 133% ග්‍රාන්ට් දීලා තමයි ඉන්දියාව ෆුඩ් ප්‍රොසෙසින් ප්ලාන්ට් දාන්නේ. ඇයි ඒගොල්ලන්ට ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් ඩෙවලොප් වෙන්න ඕනේ. හැබැයි අපි කවදාකවත් ඒව එකක්වත් බලන්නේ නැතුව අපිම හිතනවා මේ ෆ්‍රෙෂ් වෙජිටබල් ටික එක්ස්පෝට් කරන්න පුළුවන් කියලා. හැබැයි එහෙම ලෝකේ කොහෙවත් රටක් නැහැ. මොකද දැන් හැමෝම ෆුඩ් සිකියුරිටි කියලා තමන්ගේ රටේ ෆ්‍රෙෂ් වෙජිටබල් ටික හදන්න තමයි බලන්නේ. කොච්චර කොස්ට් එක වැඩි වුණත් ගවර්න්මන්ට් එකෙන් සබ්සිඩි දීලා එතකොට ඒක බලනවා. දැන් ඉතින් ඒකෙන් හැම රටක්ම තමන්ගේ ෆුඩ් සිකියුරිටි එක බලා ගන්නකොට අපිට තියෙන්නේ ප්‍රොසෙස් කරපු ෆුඩ් වලට විතරයි ඔපචුනිටි එක්ස්පෝට් කරන්න. ඉතින් අපි ඒවට ප්ලාන්ට්ස් දාන්න ප්ලෑන් එකක් හදලා එහෙම ආවේ නැත්තම් මේ ෆාමර්ස්ලා ටිකත් ළඟදිම අමාරු වෙනවා. දැන් කරම්බෝලේ ඉන්න අය මං හිතන්නේ ඒක හොබි එකට වෙන්න පුළුවන් රුපියල් 200ක් විතර වතුර දාලා වම්බුට කිලෝ එකක් ගන්න. මොකද ඩ්‍රින්කින් වෝටර් නේ අර පැලිර දාන්නේ. ඉතනට ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් වෝටර් නිස්සා. Right? ඉතින් මේක ගෙදර ඉන්නකොට හොබි එකක් හැටියට හොඳයි. يعني හැමෝටම කලම්බෝලේ ඉන්න අපි දැන් ගහන් ඉන්න අය ඔක්කොම වවලා ඇති. ඒකදී හොබි එකයි මේ මේ හිටපු ලොක්ඩවුන් එකේ ස්ට්‍රෙස් එක ගන්නත් එක වයිෆ් එක ගිහිල්ලා පොර ටික දාලා කඩන් ආවම ඒක හොඳයි. හැබැයි ඔගේ අන්තිමට ඔගේ කිලෝ එකක් ගන්න ගෙදර තියෙන ඩ්‍රින්කින් වෝටර් වතුර බිල බැලුවාම ඒ රුපියල් 200 දාලා ඉවරයි. ඒ කිලෝ එක ගන්නකොට. ඉතින් දැන් ඒවා හොබි පැත්තට තියන්න හොඳයි. හැබැයි ෆාමින් ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රි එක කියලා කිව්වහම අපේ 7.4% තමයි GDP එකෙන් තියෙන්නේ. හැබැයි 25% යැපෙන්නේ මේකේ. ඉතින් 25% යැපෙන මේකට අපි එෆෙක්ට් එකක් දාලා මේ ප්‍රොසෙසින් ෆැක්ටරිස් ටික දාලා ඒකට ફોકસ කරපු ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් එක එනකන් මේ ෆාමර්ස්ලා ගොඩ යන්නේ නැහැ නේද? ඔව්. ඉතින් එතකොට ඒ ෆාමින් ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රි එක. එතකොට 25%ක් මම එතනින් කතා කරලා ඉවරයි. දැන් ඊට පස්සේ ගත්තොත් මැනුෆැක්චරින්. ඇයි ලංකාවට මැනුෆැක්චරින් අවශ්‍ය? ඉස්සර නිස්සා දැන් අපි 1970 අහලා තියෙනවා අපේ ලිටරසි රේට් එක 96% ඒෂියාවල තියෙන බෙස්ම ලිටරසි රේට් එක. මොකද්ද මේ ලිටරසි රේට් එක කියන්නේ? කියවන්න පුළුවන් එක. ඒ කියන්නේ ටවුන් එකකට ගියාම අතරමං වෙන්නේ නැතුව ගෙදර එන්න පුළුවන්. කියන්නේ බෝඩ් එක කියවන්න පුළුවන්, බස් එකේ බෝඩ් එක කියවන්න පුළුවන්, ලේන් එකේ බෝඩ් එක කියවන්න පුළුවන් ඒක. But today is a functional literacy rate. අපේ එකේ functional literacy rate එක ලංකාවේ 38%. ඇයි? අපි යුනිවර්සිටි ඇන්ඩ් ටෙක්නිකල් කොලෙජ් වලින් ට්‍රේන් එම්ප්ලොයිමන්ට් එකට රෙඩි කරන්නේ 38%. එතකොට මේ ඩේටා අරන් බලන්න යුනිවර්සිටි වල අවුට්පුට් එකයි ටෙක්නිකල් කොලෙජස් වල අවුට්පුට් එකයි ට්‍රේනින් ඔක්කොම 38%. එතකොට අපි 62% එළියට දානවා අන්ස්කිල් ලේබර් එක. එතකොට අන්ස්කිල් කියලා කියන පාර්ට් එක තමයි ඉස නොට් අ ෆන්ක්ෂනල් ලිටරසි. එතකොට කවුරුත් දැන් අපි අර 1970 වෙන අවුරුදු 50කට ඉස්සෙල්ලා හිටපු තියරි එකේ ඉන්නවා මිනිහෙක් අතරමං නොවී ගෙදර එන්න තමයි අර රේට් එක දෙන්නේ. හැබැයි තාම කතා කරන්නේ ඒ ලිටරසි රේට් එක ගැන. ඉතින් එතකොට දැන් 62ක් ඉන්නවා මෙන්න මෙතනදි තමයි මේ අපිට මැනුෆැක්චරින් කියන කෑල්ල ඕන වෙන්නේ. මොකද සර්විස් සෙක්ටර් එකට යන්න අනිවාර්යයෙන්ම ට්‍රේන් කරන්න. ඉතින් අපිට ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රීස් නැතුව මේක ගොඩ ගන්න බෑ. බැ ඉන්ඩස්ට්‍රීස් හරි චැලෙන්ජින් බිකෝස් ඔෆ් ද $4,000 per capita. සැලරි ලෙවල්ස් ආයි. ඉතින් එතකොට මේක ටැක්ස් කන්සර්න් දීලා මේක ආරක්ෂා කරගත්තේ නැත්තම් ආරක්ෂා කරන්න බෑ. මොකද දැන් හොඳම එක්සැම්පල් එක අපි මේ වගේ තිබිලා දැන් හැමෝම කියනවා ඩිරෙක්ට් ඇන් ඉන්ඩිරෙක්ට් ටැක්සස් කියලා. හැබැයි මේගොල්ලෝ කතා කරන්නේ GDP එකට against corporate and dividend tax වල total එක. You go and see the USA that from the total government revenue the percentage of the GDP that the corporate and the dividend tax is only 1.5%.
Okay.
The US, you know, the total they are the 20 trillion economy, the 3000 billion is their revenue, right? Is only 300 billion is the corporate tax. It's a 1.5%. Even the Sri Lanka is same. The Sri Lanka is same කියන්නේ growth එකක් නැතුව මෙහෙම ගන්න ගියාම industries නම් ඕනේ මේකට කවුරුත් එන්නේ නැහැ නිසා. මේ tax holidays tikai me grants tikai especially food processing industry එකට ඒ වගේ grant එකක් ප්ලාස්ටික් කරේ නැත්තම් 133% ඉන්දියාවේ දෙනකොට අපි 100% දුන්නත් එන්නේ නැහැ මිනිස්සු why they have to come here their package is 133% plus 10 years tax holiday එතකොට agriculture එකට අපිට වෙනම focus කරලා වෙනම package එකක් කලන් වෙනවා is a food processing but then you have to look the industry එතකොට මේ sectors වලින් තමයි අර ටික ගන්න මෙන්න normal economy එක තියාගෙන යන්න නම් අපි every year according to the world bank we have to create a new jobs 62000 ඒ කියන්නේ same level එකේ තියන් යන්න
ඔව් නැ ධම්මික හරි මම කියන්නේ දැන් මෙතන මේ ධම්මික අපනායන ගැන කතා කරා exports ගැන but මේ recession එකක් ඉදිරියේදී තියෙද්දී අපිට මේ exports වලින් මේ 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 තත්ත්වෙන් ගොඩ එන්න පුළුවන්ද I want Nevada also to
country එක ඇතුලේ තියෙන consumption එක එකයි නේ agriculture sector එකේ
ඔව්
මේක growth එකක් ගන්න බෑනේ අපි අලකනවා නම් මේ මේක season seasonal අර ඔක්කොම අපිට මේ 1% වලින් තමයි වැඩි වෙන්නේ මොකද human ලංකාවේ growth එක තියෙන 1% ඒතර ඒ 1% එකට අපි මේ මිනිස්සු මොකද $4000 කියලා කියන්නේ farm එකේ මේ income එක double කරන්න ඕන ඒතර income එක double කරන්න වෙන්නේ crop එක double කරලා crop එක ඩබල් කරාට වැඩක් නැහැ මොකද කන්න මිනිස්සු නැහැ ඒක කන්න තියෙන පිටරට මිනිස්සු ඒතර පිටරට මිනිස්සු නම් ඒ crop එක අපි අරින්න ඕනේ ඒ අරින්න නම් is only the process the process කරන්න you need the industries to come
okay නිවාඩ්
yeah go ahead
No, I just following up from what Dhammika mentioned. I remember reading Prime Minister's May Day message, where he said that the old economic model has failed. That we must look at a new economic model, new economic policies. What did he mean by that? I mean, there is some concern that will we be going for more protectionist, more domestic-oriented, inward-looking policies? Given, I mean. I don't know whether this is an overreaction or whether it's that the real stated policy of the government.
I think what we need to understand is models will change. The model that we had in the past, in the context of all these challenges that are taking place, Nista, that will definitely change. Because take, for example, the situation with regard to agriculture. Now, we were comfortable about importing certain types of products into the country while growing some of the others. But now, sometimes what we have encountered in this particular post-COVID period is that many countries are reluctant to part with their produce because they want to keep it for themselves. And naturally so. We would do the same thing if we were in the same position because earlier, if they were keeping a buffer stock of 6 months, they'll probably now keep a buffer stock of 1.5 years. So during that period, there will be a less amount that is available for export. Because those countries are also looking at a protectionist type of situation in the interest of their own citizens. So we do the same thing, perhaps. So, and at the same time, it gives us an opportunity of shifting our own business processes to get our people to also produce certain produce which we were comfortable in importing in the past. So it gives us a new opportunity. At the same time, it gives us a new market as well. So that's what I think the Prime Minister meant when he mentioned that. And I believe that's a very important shift that we'll have to look at. But I would go a step further, Nista. Now, you see, our economy is as Dhammika quite rightly mentioned, is a 15 trillion rupee economy. Now, when you have a 15 trillion rupee economy and the component of agriculture is about 1 trillion, although in the agricultural sector, it seems fairly robust. In the overall context of our economy, it's a relatively smaller proportion. So if we want to maintain our per capita incomes, our growth, as well as our overall economy at a certain level, and for it to grow in the eyes of the world, we will not be able to do that with agriculture alone. True enough, there are huge opportunities in agriculture as well as needs which we must now focus upon, which we should do. There's no doubt about that. I fully subscribe to that model. But at the same time, I would think that some of the threats that we are facing now in industry as well as in our services need to be addressed with a lot of urgency, because that can be the factor that can either cripple our economy or allow it to go forward in these trying times. Because if you take the economy as an overall situation, services actually account for nearly 60%, maybe about 59% is services. Insurance services, banking, tourism, transportation, storage, lots of services of that nature. Now, these services have to be also either maintained at least at the earlier levels or enhanced. Maybe that there'll be a shift, and that's natural. But we got to be conscious of that and then take it forward on those lines. Even the industry, we are taking a hit. The apparel sector is taking a hit. And that means very quickly, we need to readjust. So I think our strategy should not be only agriculture driven. It should be also the overall industry as well as services driven as well. And I believe that many people think of agriculture as being the obvious one. Well, there is a certain element of that which is important. But I would think that the rest of it is also as important, and we should not neglect those, because we got to find ways and means of ensuring that we improve our IT services, our IT exports, a lot of things that can be done, but now needs to be done in a different manner. And the demand in the world also would change. So we have got to also appreciate that part. So if we can handle it on those lines, I believe we would be on the right track. And it's a very delicate as well as important balance that we need to strike. And I don't know whether we have enough entrepreneurs who are able to come into these new sectors as well as start switching. Now, even the entrepreneurs that we have today, they are also comfortable in certain areas. They're done well in certain areas. But there will be a time very quickly that they have to think, hey, we've not got to change. We got to also make sure that we change in order to stay relevant. Now, take, for example, some of the garment manufacturers. I believe they will have work in the medium term. There's no question about it, because people still have to wear clothes. But at the same time, right now, the need seems to be not garments. The need seems to be PPEs, the protective clothing and the protective equipment. So if you can switch some of your work towards that end and then do well in that area, then I believe there'll be plenty of work. So how you switch and whether you can switch fast is important. They say the new norm in the world is not how big you are, but how fast you are. How quickly can you adjust? How quickly can you move from one sector to another sector? So I think that's an important factor for us to be looking at. And if we can get that right, I believe we can also get our act together quickly. And that's what we need to do now.
මේ ධම්මික නෑ මේ I'm just a question. දැන් අපි සීනි කර්මාන්තය ගත්තත් අපි දැන් හැම රජයක්ම කියලා තිනවා සීනි කර්මාන්තය ගොඩනගන්නේ අපිට අපි මම හිතන්නේ මිලියන 300ක් විතර අවුරුද්දකට ඩොලර් මිලියන 300ක් විතර වියදම් කරනවා සීනි ආනයනය කරලා ධම්මික හිතන්නේ මොන වගේ ප්‍රශ්නද තියෙන්නේ මේක තාමත් අපි කිරි කර්මාන්තය ගත්තත් සීනි කර්මාන්තය ගත්තත් ඔය ප්‍රශ්නේ තියෙනවා දැන් මෙතන ඉම්පෝට් රිස්ට්‍රික්ෂන්ස් වගේ දාලා තිනවා මේ අවුරුද්දේ ෆොරින් එක්ස්චේන්ජ් මැනේජ් කරගන්න ඉදිරියේදීත් මං හිතන්නේ මේක තව අවුරුද්දකට විතර එයි එතකොටත් මං හිතන්නේ ආනයනය කරන දේවල් දේවල් නවත්තන්න වෙයි එතනක් තියෙනවා මේ ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් ප්‍රොඩක්ට්ස් උත් තියෙනවා එතන
දැන් මෙහෙමයි මං ආයි ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් කියන පටන් ගත්තොත් මං ඇයි ඒක කතා කරන්නේ මේ 4000 ඩොලර් එක 6500 ගෙනියනකොට මේ 25% මේ ඇග්‍රිකල්චර් සෙක්ටර් එකෙන් ලීව් කරන එක මේක අඩු කරන්න වෙනවා අඩුම ගානේ 17% වෙනවා25% families live කරන ඒකේ තමයි මම වැඩිපුර කතා කරේ. හැබැයි size එක ගත්තොත් මේ GDP growth එකට help කරන එක ගත්තොත් 7.4%. ඒතර 7.4% එකක් අපි කියමුකෝ 20% වලින් grow කරා 20% වලින් grow කරා total economic grow වෙන්නේ 1.5 ඉතින් ඒකෙන් අර එන impact එක එච්චර අඩුයි හැබැයි අර ජීවත් වෙන්න ඕන හින්දා මිනිස්සු ජීවත් කරවන්න ඕන හින්දායි මේ future අර අපි 25ම continue කරමු කියන්නේ දැනුත් අපි උගන්වන්නේ නැතුව ළමයි ටික farm එකකට ඇරියොත් මේක huge problem එකක් වෙනවා මොකද agriculture කියන එක $4,000 පෙන්නට පස්සේ සාමාන්‍ය දැන් US වගේ රටක් ගත්තොත් 1% මේ 1% වලින් මේ 8% එකේ output එක ගන්නවා දැන් ඉතින් අපිටත් ඇත්තටම කරන්න තියෙන්නේ හොඳම දේ තමයි මේ ළමයින් education පැත්තට දාලා මේක මේ productivity එක වැඩි කරොත් මේ product එක වැඩි කරත් අර export එක ඕනේ ඒ පැත්ත හැබැයි දැන් ඔයා ගත්තොත් sugar එක ගත්තොත් මේ sugar එක මේ land ලොකු කර්මාන්ත වලට දෙන්න එපා ඔක්කොම කියන මේ peoples මොනේ protect කරන්නේ එක පැත්තකින් ප්‍රොටෙක්ට් කරනවා අනිත් පැත්තෙන් ඕනේ කියනවා. ඒතර ඒ කියන මං හිතන්නේ sugar factory එකක් ගහන්න තව 3 years විතරයි ගහනම නම්. ඔය ලෑන්ඩ්ස් ටික දීලා ওই වගේ වැඩක් කරන්න මොකද මිනිස්සු ගන්නකොට political parties එක පැත්තකින් අනිත් පැත්තට උසු ගන්නවා. ඉතින් කවදාකවත් ඒ ජොබ් එක කරන්න හම්බෙන්නේ නැහැ. මම හිතන විදිහට කියන්නේ කවුරුහරි ඇවිල්ලා මේකෙන් at least $300 million එකකින් $100 million ප්‍රොඩියුස් කරන්න පුළුවන් නම් ලොකු දෙයක්. මේ මේකට ලෑන්ඩ් එකක් දෙන්න බෑ කාට හරි. ඒතර ඒ ලෑන්ඩ් එක දීලා මේ වැඩ ටික කරන්න at least take another 3-4 years if somebody is interesting ani me kirigoviyange gatta same problem එක මොකද අපි ගොවි දැන් මේක chicken and egg situation එක දැන් අපේ මේ තනකොළ ಜಾති මේ 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 ලංකාවේ තනකොළ වවන්න නැතුව හරක් ගේන ඉතින් එතකොට තනකොළ වවන්න නැතුව හරක් ගෙනාම හරක් අර නිකන් normal තනකොළ කාලා බඩ ගිල්ල මැරෙනවා මේ 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 ඉන්නේ farm වල ඉන්න හරක් තර් මේක ඇත්තටම මේ ගොවියෙකුට මේ දෙන්නෙක් තුන්දෙනෙක් බලා ගන්න පුළුවන් ಜಾති හරක් නෙමෙයි මේ 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 අර අර හයිබ්‍රිඩ් හරක් ටික ඒගොල්ලන් ෆාම් එකක දාලා ඒ ටයිප් එකේ තනකොළ දෙන්න ඕනේ ඉතින් ඒ ටයිප් එකේ තනකොළ දෙන්න ඕනේ අනිත් එක ඒ ටයිප් එකේ වෙදර එක තියෙන්න ඕනේ ඉතින් අපි වැරදි වෙදර එකකට දාලා අර අනිත් තනකොළ දුන්නාම ගේන හරක් ටික මැරෙනවා දැන් කියන්නේ ලෙඩ හරක් ගෙනාවා ලෙඩ හරක් ගෙන්නේ නැහැ හොඳ හරක් ගෙනල්ලා මේ ලෙඩ හදලා මරනවා මේ ඔක්කොම කරොත් කිරිප්‍රයිතර කවුරු 3 times කියවන්නේ නැහැ මේක හැමතිස්සෙම මේ මේ දෙක ඉවලුවෙට් කරන ග්‍රාන්ට්ස් නැතුව මේ ප්‍රයිස් එක තියාගන්න බැරි නිසා ඒක තමයි මේක වෙන්නේම නැත්තේ
ඕකේ දැන් right thank you just we'll wrap up this on the economic side as to in a situation where there is likely to be negative growth I mean and tourism may not really bounce back till December or beyond December that's the forecast I think we have few options such as agriculture construction to generate this kind of growth do you agree with that thinking Nivad and Dhammika I mean what do you think would be the quick industries or sectors that can really produce that kind of growth in the next 12 to 24 months
I think the important thing here is Nista as far as those areas which are affected to hold you have to hold those okay. because the time will come for it to do well so sometimes if you damage it beyond a certain level then it's very difficult for them to get back that is why I think the industrialists the business people the companies have to be protected to some extent sometimes the word protection is not very well received by certain people but I think if you want to make sure that the fabric remains stable you got to protect it for some time and the government will have to step in for that and the government will have to find ways and means to protect it and then take it forward so that when the good times come those are still relevant and being able to do something at the same time this overall fallout from this COVID has told us that there will be certain differences in which the world will function in the future okay ඉදිරියේදී කටයුතු කරන විදිය වෙනස් වෙනවාමයි එහෙම වෙනස් වෙනවා නම් අපිට සිදු වෙනවා ඒ වෙනසටත් හැඩ ගැසෙන්න. We have to prepare ourselves to that change as well. So two things will have to happen. One is hold on to what we have with certain adjustments so that we can be relevant when the time changes. But at the same time, make use of the changes that are taking place so that we shift and reposition our businesses to be able to enjoy that benefit as well. We have to do both. That is, අපි කොහොමද කරලා අලුත් තැනට යොමු වෙන්න සඳහා අපි අපේ කටයුතු හදගස්ස ගන්නට ඕනේ. ඒ සඳහා අපි ඒ තීරණ ගැනීමදී හිතාගෙන බලන්නට ඕනේ කොහොමද අපි ඉදිරියට යන්නේ කියලා ඒ පැත්තෙන්. අනිත් පැත්තෙන් අපිට දැන් තියෙන challenge එකට මුහුණ දෙන්නීමට යම්කිසි කාලයක් අවශ්‍යයි. ඒ කාලය තුළදී අපේ තියෙන මේ ව්‍යාපාර රැක ගැනීමට අපිට අවශ්‍ය වෙනවා. ඉතින් ව්‍යාපාර රැක ගැනීම සඳහා අපි දැනටමත් කතා කරගෙන තියෙන විවිධ මෙවලම් කරා we have already spoken about certain ways in which our industries can be to some extent protected during this difficult period. And those, maybe if you want to talk about it further, we can do so. But the important philosophy and the concept is that we have to do both simultaneously, not one only. So if we do that, we will still be able to make sure that the growth can take place even for the future. I think as we talked earlier, this year is going to be a very challenging year. And if we can even eke out a small percentage growth, it will be a great bonus. But I don't foresee that taking place with ease. It can happen. But I think it's going to be a very challenging task to get some growth this year overall. Because from a 15 trillion economy, with that kind of shock that we have so far felt and envisaged and experienced, it's difficult for us to move further. But having said that, I think if we can protect ourselves to be in a situation where we can enjoy from the next year onwards, then we would have done well. And that's how we should fashion our economy over the next few months.
Okay,
yeah. Now, I see from world leaders that they are coming with a more honest assessment that recovery will take time, get ready for tough times, you know, there's kind of announcements coming. But I think we had an announcement from President Rajapaksa saying that he was confident that the economy can be revived. And, you know, he was talking about attracting FDIs, promote getting tourism. And I mean, shouldn't you prepare the nation for tougher times ahead? And, you know, in advance saying, look, we will have negative growth this year. Can you adjust? Rather than trying to create some, you know, false sense of hope when you know exactly that things may be, you know, you can't even make any assessment.
No, Mr., you know, the Prime Minister and the President is not telling like that, right? Everybody will give the negative thinking. You know, we cannot live like that. You know, so the leaders have to take the positive steps, right? Because some sectors, I will give you a good example, the education sector, right? මම කොවිඩ් එක මගේ ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එකක් තිබුණා DP Education maths උගන්වන ප්‍රොජෙක්ට් එකක් වීඩියෝ කන්ටෙන්ට් වල YouTube channel එකක් අරින්. හැබැයි මම මේක ඩිසెంబර් වල අරින්න හිටියේ. හැබැයි මම කර්ෆියු දාපු first day එකම තියෙන කන්ටෙන්ට්, ඒ කියන්නේ 33% 34% විතර කන්ටෙන්ට්ස් තිබුණා. It's a 5 hours 5000 hours recording. ඉතින් ඒකෙන් 1500 hours recording තිබුණා. මම ඒක දාලා මම YouTube channel එක පටන් ගත්තා. දන්නවාද ඊ දවසට 55,000 ස්ටුඩන්ට්ස් YouTube එකේ DP Education එකේ මැත්ස් ඉගෙන ගන්න. හරි එතකොට ලංකාවේ ඉන්න බෙස්මම ටීචර්ව දාලා මම උගන්වන්න. දැන් වා හිතනවාද ආයි මැත්ස් වලට ලංකාවේ ප්‍රශ්නයක් වෙයි කියලා. කියන්නේ මැත්ස් උගන ගන්න මම හිතන්නේ ආයි ප්‍රශ්නයක් වෙයි කියලා. ඔයාලට බලන්න පුළුවන් මම මේ සිකුරාදාට ලොන්ච් කරනවා DP Digital University. බයි ඒකේ ට ගියාට පස්සේ මුළු ලෝකෙම තියෙන ෆ්‍රී ඔන්ලයින් කෝසස් වලට එන්ට වෙන්න පුළුවන්. දැන් ඒකට අප මම ඇත්තටම දැන් චැට්බොට් කෙනෙක්ව මම හදාගෙන යනවා. දැන් හදලා ඉවරයි චැට්බොට්. හැබැයි මම ධම්මික පෙරට දෙන ආන්සර්ස් 2000ක් මම ඒක ඇතුලේ බිල් කරනවා. ඒ කියන්නේ චැට්බොට් දෙන්නේ ඒ කියන්නේ මට I have to wait until the like a 10,000 questions come because of that take time. Then I will train the chatbot මම හිතන විදිහට හිතලා මේකට උත්තර දෙන්න. උත්තර ඒ ප්‍රශ්න first 10,000 වලටම මම රෙඩි වෙලා ඉන්නේ personally මම ආන්සර් කරා. ඒ ළමයි. ඒ කියන්නේ WhatsApp වෙන answers ටිකට but ඊට පස්සේ the chatbot will take over the job. ඉතින් හැබැයි මමත් දැන් බලන්න දැන් education එක කොයි level එකට යයිද කියලා මෙතන. මොකද දැන් අපි හිතන් හිටියට දැන් ඇත්තටම banking sector එක වුණත් වයසක අය වුණත් දැන් ගිහිල්ලා බැංකුවේ ට්‍රාන්සැක්ෂන් එක කරගන්න පුළුවන්. ඉස්සර බැංකුවට ගියා. මොකද 1 and a half months මේ වගේ තිබ්බට පස්සේ ගොඩක් ඩිජිටල් පැත්තට චේන්ජ් වෙලා ඉවරයි. නැත්තම් මේ චේන්ජ් එක ඉන්න තව 5 years යනවා. ඉතින් දැන් මේ 1 and a half years එකේ 1 month එකේ වෙච්ච පොසිටිව් ටිකත් අතර ගන්න ඕනේ. මොකද අරගෙන මොකද මම අර දැන් ඔය ඔක්කොම කියන්නේ এডুকেෂන් එකත් එක්ක බැඳිලා තියෙන්නේ. ෆාමෝ හැදෙන්නේ এডুকেෂන් එක මදි හින්දා. මිනිස්සු හිරේ ඉන්නේ এডুকেෂන් එක මදි හින්දා. හොඳම එක්සැම්පල් එකක් ගත්තොත් ලංකාවේ හිරේ ඉන්න අයගෙන් 85% below grade 8 ඉගෙන ගන්නවා. ඒ මොකද හැම අවුරුද්දෙම 28000 drop outs තියෙනවා 6000 ස්කූල යන්නේ. හැම අවුරුද්දෙම 34000 අපි හිරේ යන්න හදනවා. එතකොට දැන් ඒ හිරේ යන්න හදන එක අඩු වෙනව මේ වැඩේ. මේ විදිහට ඉගෙන ගන්න ලෑස්ති කරාට පස්සේ cost එක අඩු වෙනවා. ඉතින් අපිට මොනිටර් කරන්න ලේසි digital ඇවිල්ලා තියෙනවා. ඉතින් මං හිතන්නේ මේ ඔක්කොටම මේ වගේ 1 and a half months එක very good. හැබැයි දැන් future එක මම හිතනවා තව 8 months විතර මේක තියේ කියලා. ඒ තියෙනකත් එක්ක අපි circuit breaker ගන්න. example එකක් දැන් ගෙදරක rooms වල හැම එකටම circuit breaker එක තියෙන්න පුළුවන්. නැත්තම් ගෙදරටම circuit breakers දෙකක් තියෙන්න පුළුවන්. ඒ කියන්නේ උඩ තට්ටුවටයි යට තට්ටුවටයි. ඒතකොට උඩ තට්ටුවේ short එකක් වුණොත් උඩ තට්ටුවම වහනවා. හැබැයි හැම කාමරයකටම circuit breaker එක ගන්න තිබුණා නම් කාමරේ විතරයි වහන්නේ. ඒ වගේ දැන් අපි කියමුකෝ මේකේ next 8 months වල වෙන්න පුළුවන් දේවල් තමයි spike එනවා. ඒතකොට spike එකහම ලංකාවේ මිනිස්සු panic කරනවා හැමෝම panic කරනවා. Then you will put the one week curfew. Then you will disturb the whole economy. හැබැයි spike එක ආවට පස්සේ දන්නවනම් මේක spike එකක්, එක place එකක spike එකක් කියලා then we no need to worry. That circuit breakers have to be a small like a 300 families. Like a grama sayaka area. If you put into the district if say one place they have a spike with the particular place then you can close down the 300 the houses you know like a gram sevaka kottasaya then a small circuit break if you put in the big circuit breaker mean the for the district then will disturb the whole economy but same time nista we no need to worry that now because of the they put the curfew only the last 1.5 months is essential economies there non-essential economy is not there right the essential economy is agriculture manufacturing fmb food and beverage and the government sector salaries right because of that is a 20% but it's not a revenue generator right the balance 80% is the revenue generator because of that the government also lost each day the government revenue each day is a 5 billion right for the government to pay the government servant each they may need 3 billion rupees pay the interest they need another 3 billion then they need 6 billion to pay that two part then meka ahang inna hamogema mainma concern dekai ne tiyene ekak salary gewanna ona ekak bank ekek interest gewanna ona so government ekek tiyene e concern ekak government ekek issellama government service lage salary gewanna one ara interest burn wenna interest ekek gewanna ether government ekata tiyena 6 billion per day problem ekak wen revenue ekak 5 billion කොහෙන්ද දැන් මේ දවස් ටිකටම ඇවිල්ලා නැහැ ඒ ඉන්කම් එක. The government also in trouble because of they have no revenue. This is the reason you can see the letter is going around to say that you know the government servants also have a salary cut. Go to you know donate the salary to the government. The reason is like that because they are also in that trouble. If we hope we can get money from them then we wait until it's not get we'll get then we will have problem better our own we have to plan ourselves you know our plan
okay
because we know the numbers the government also what is the government revenue and what is the government expenditure to just to pay the salary and the interest right because of that they also lost the revenue then they are also in trouble right otherwise you know no government won't send the letter no even though just in the half right because of that everyone can have to understand that part but I also agree with Mr. Kabral that the first 2 months it will be a little bit challenge to face nicely for that challenge I think maybe that after that it will normalize but only thing my concern the spike come if they close the district again then we cannot plan anything
okay fine Nivad just there was reference to about we'll go for some questions but before that I just want to ask how successful has I mean on the moratorium and the financial assistance, I mean, you spoke about the speed in which we need to move on. There's some disappointment that that kind of speed that was expected didn't take place. So the extension has, the deadline has been extended further. There are a lot of complaints because this working capital has to pay salaries and other things. So there's a bit of concern on the speed, and also some feel that the whole stimulus package has eroded confidence rather than increasing confidence.
I'll try and explain to you, Nista, how it works. Yeah. You see, now, when you're a leader, you got to also fashion the future. You're not a follower. If the leaders say, look, this year is bad and we are going to die, and then we have to just sit back and wait, then nothing is going to happen. So you have to create the future. That's what leaders do. So sometimes you say you fashion the future, you create it, you first of all articulate what your future should be. If the president and the prime minister say we are going to have a negative growth, then I think we'll all get used to that negative growth. And then we'll say, okay, we'll all get used to that and then we'll continue like that. But they have to say, no, look, we'll have to do something which will take us forward. And then we have to strive for that. So I think they're on the right track by saying, you know, we must strive for positive growth. And it's up to the people who are managing the economy as well as managing the rest of the businesses to also strive for that. So I think I'm pretty certain that what has been done in that score is good. The second part of the question that you mentioned is with regard to the stimulus as well as the moratorium and so on. I must say, I'm also not pleased with the way it has been implemented. There are lots of gaps. They took a long time in getting it off the ground. The period by which it was done was far too long. They took a long time to get this into shape. So I think we got to learn from those mistakes. Next time round, now those fortunately were the responses to the downturn in the economy that had taken place. And it was too slow. It was not clear enough. It didn't get right down to the banks as well as the finance companies so that it could get implemented. And I see several areas where that implementation has been weak. So we had to get those lessons and work that out for the next time. This time round, as I said, there is a timeout period. In the timeout period, we got to get our responses ready and to make sure that the next stage of moratorium or some other initiative that we're doing is implemented fast. The central bank and the Ministry of Finance and the other ministries will have to work very fast. That is why I think there must be a clear mandate as well, Nista, for this. There must be a clear mandate. You see, for the public service to get going, for the banks to also get going, they must all believe that we have a overall mandate as far as the government's edict goes. So when the government says we want something done, they must be confident that that's what is going to take place. So in a way, these are all connected. And I would like to see the election being held so that there is a clear mandate being given by the people. So whichever government, it can be any government, but hold the election, have the government in place, because you need a very strong government at this stage for the public service to respond, for the businesses to respond, for investors to have clarity, for the world to know Sri Lanka is open for business or what. Whatever the stage that the Sri Lankan government is saying, that needs to have clarity. Now, at the moment, it's very difficult for a, I use the word for this, like a Nonagate government. You know, you are neither here nor there. Nonagate is not a good time to start doing anything. I know my friend, Dhammika Perra, also is a firm believer of that kind of thing. There are certain periods of time when there's no clarity, there's no certainty. So you need to get certainty. You need to get clarity. So if you can get clarity, then the businesses will know this is the policy of the government. This is what is expected by the industry. Then you can give clear instructions. You can give clear way forward strategies. And I think to do that, we got to establish those norms as soon as possible. And if you do that, then we'll probably find that there will be people responding. Now, even that idea that I gave some time ago of having a COVID equity fund. Now, to get a COVID equity fund going, the equity fund investors of the world must have clarity. There must be a very clear statement made, which you know is going to hold water, because that is with the powerful support of the government. Now, even if you were to have a moratorium today, that moratorium will be weak as the current interim government that we are having. So naturally, it will not have the same impact and effect as it would have in a proper government. So let's get that going. Let's get that into place. Once you have that, whichever the government is, doesn't matter, because then there is clarity and then you can go forward. So I believe we have a huge necessity for that. And if you can get that right, we will also make sure that the response is clear and the government is also able to put that down properly. As you said, you asked whether the president and the prime minister are doing the right thing by saying this. I think, yes, even in this uncertain world, they must show intent. So they say some people make things happen. There are others who wonder what's happening. So in order to get the people who are wondering what's happening to go into the right track, you got to have a clarity as far as what your vision is and what your overall need is and the output that you want to have is. So let's see how that goes in the next few months and weeks.
Yeah. So my question was in the context that you're asking the public to tighten the belt. You're asking employees to take pay cuts. You're asking so many other cost-cutting austerity measures. So in that context, if you do come with more sincerity, people will voluntarily come with, otherwise you don't have to send a letter from Secretary to the President to ask for a pay cut, donate half of your pay to salvage the situation. So that my question was in that context.
Okay. I appreciate that. And I think pay cuts or pay donations are all must come voluntarily. And people are generous in their time, in their way that they would offer their services, in the way that they would offer their money. We have seen that in Sri Lanka on many, many occasions. And I think even this time round, there are a lot of people who have very silently given their wealth, given their support, given their ideas, given their money to get this situation into place. And I think we should remember that there are a lot of people like that also in Sri Lanka.
Okay. Right. Dhammika, I want a quick answer from you about elections, because Niwad brought this up. You think we need to go ahead with elections?
Mr. Maker and last 5 years give you that හැම ඉයර එකකටම ඩොලර් 6ක් තමයි වැඩි උනේ. ඒ කියන්නේ 6 ඩොලර්ස් තමයි GDP growth එක තියෙන්නේ. දැන් මේ විදිහට තියන් ගියොත් මුකුත් කරන්න බෑ. කොයි පාටියකද නෙවෙයි එන එක. මේ ඉලෙක්ෂන් නොතියා මේ කවුරු ඩිසිෂන් ගන්න මිනිස්සු නැතුව මේ විදිහට තියන් ගියොත් එහෙම මේ රට තවත් පස්සට යනවා මිස මොකද තියෙන බය? මම අහන්නේ කාටද මේ බය තියෙන්නේ? ඒ ෆියර් එක තියෙන අයට වේට් එකක් බොන්න කියන්න ඕනේ. හරි අදවයිස් you have to come forward and මේ වෝට් එකක් දානවා කියන එක මහා ලොකු දෙයක්ද? හැබැයි ෆියර් එකක් ක්‍රියේට් කරලා දිනන මොකද්ද මේ මම අහන්නේ මොකද්ද ප්‍රොබ්ලම් එක තියෙන්නේ? වෝට් එක දාන්න යන එකනේ. හරි හැම මිනිස්සුම හිටියෙ ඉඳලා වැට යන්න ඕනේ. වැට යන්නේ නැතුව ගෙදර හිටියොත් එමු නෝපේ. ඉතින් එතකොට හැම මිනිස්සුම වැට යන්න ඕන නම් මේකේ අපි කියමුකෝ බරයි මේකේ රිස්ක් එකක් තියෙනවා අවුරුදු 60 කට වඩා උඩරයිද කියලා. ඉතින් ඒගොල්ලන්ට පොඩි මෙෂර්මන්ට් එකක් ඒගොල්ලෝ පර්සනල් එකක් නේ. මේක ෆෝස් කරන එකක් නෙමෙයි වෝට් කරනවා කියන එක. කැමතිය අය ඒ කැමතිය නෝයි. හැබැයි මේක හෝල් කරන්න ගියොත් හරියට CEO කෙනෙක් නැති කම්පැනික් වගේ. CEO කෙනෙක් නැති කම්පැනි එකට මොකද වෙන්නේ? අකවුන්ටන්ට් ඩිසිෂන් ගන්නවා, සේල්ස් මැනේජර් එක ඩිසිෂන් ගන්නවා, ෂෝරූම් මැනේජර් ඩිසිෂන් එක ගන්නවා. හැමෝම අරගෙන නිකන් ඉන්නවා. ඒත් ඔහොම රටවල් දුවන්න බෑ. මන් දන්නේ මේ ඇයි බය මොකටද කියලා. කාටවත් බය වෙන දෙයක් නෑ නිසා ඉලෙක්ෂන් කියන මොකද්ද මේකේ? ඉලෙක්ෂන් නිසා නෝට ගෝස් මොකටද බය වෙන්නේ මේ ඉලෙක්ෂන් එකට?
ඕකේ. Thank you. Okay, thank you. Interesting.
අනිත් එක අපිට කියලා වගේ අපිට පුළුවන් නම් කඩේට ගිහිල්ලා බඩු ගන්න. අපිට පුළුවන් නම් මේ අපේ බිල් ගෙවන්න යන්න. ඒ වැඩ ටික කරගන්න කාර් වල යන්න මේ දැන් මේ ඊපෙරද කිව්වා මේ ගොඩක් සාප් වලට යන්න මිනිස්සු බලාගෙන ඉන්නවා කියලා. ඉතින් ඒ වගේ සාමාන්‍ය ජන ජීවිතයේ වැඩ වලට මිනිස්සු හැඩ ගැසෙනවා. හරිද මේක ඔය
කියන්නේ ඉලෙක්ෂන් එකට ෆෝස් කරලා කියන්නේ නැහැ නේ බලේ.
කියන්නේ නැහැ.
Yeah, I think, yeah, I mean, I think political parties have their own reasons for suggesting postponement. Anyway, the what we will do is we'll take some questions. There are a lot of questions to the two panelists. What I'll do is, there is an early question is, Nivad, about your proposal to part of the stimulus is to get EPF, 20% of EPF balances to be given to the members. There were various issues whether it is practical in terms of you need to amend the EPF Act. Other one is about this means liquidating some of the investments that EPF had made in the bonds and bills. Can you expand a bit on the proposal, Nivad, and what has been the response from the government?
I think what was proposed was to make sure that there is way forward for a lot of people to make ends meet right now. If you look at the figures of the central bank, there are about 18 lakhs of people who have got their credit cards at the top bank. There's about 125 billion rupees outstanding on credit cards alone. People own all the other loans. So a lot of people are today struggling to make ends meet. They are struggling to make sure that their home fires are burning. Many people are unable to do anything, which means that they have to make any small investment. So I think if we were to wait till they are 55, some people who want to wait till 55, they can certainly wait. But the others, if they can get some relief as early as possible, then that will be a great help, particularly at this moment of time when they are all faced with some serious liquidity issues. Then at the same time, many of them can settle their loans. They will be able to get some new activity going. Sometimes they may be waiting for something to do in their family, which they could not do because they are so stuck in their monetary situation.
Yeah. How do you?
They have a 250 billion annual income, the interest. Then it's a monthly, it's a the 20 billion. Actually, that the interest component is enough to provide that 20%. Because if we announce 100% not going to ask the 20%, no. The people are in the problem, they will ask the money. Say 50% people will ask, then it's only 250 billion. The 250 billion for the next 1 year with their interest, they can pay no.
Okay, right.
Of course. So it's actually finding the money is not a difficulty. But at the same time, you will also find that they will start economic activity. Economy will again get some oil put into that machine. And that's very important because otherwise, as I mentioned at the beginning, you see, you must have demand created in the country as well. Demand must be there in the economy. Even if you ask hotels to start, even if you ask the businesses to start, someone has to buy the products. Someone has to be there to with some cash to buy. So if you don't have that, and the people are all struggling and they're all going into a contracting mode, then the whole economy will start contracting and contracting and contracting. And the contraction itself feeds further contraction. Austerity feeds further austerity. So you'll never be able to have any growth. So that is why at some stage, there must be some infusion of cash so that will also create a new impetus and people will get more and more buoyant in going about their work. So I think it's necessary to, they don't like it. I don't know what prompts it because sometimes I think people don't like ideas coming from others as well. So that's also another problem. So, I think at this moment, you have to shed that. You have to see what is the merit or demerits of an idea. And there may be certain ways in which you have to do it, as Dhammika quite rightly mentioned. There is an easy way of doing it as well. Why won't they look at it? So I think in due course, when there's clarity as far as governments are concerned, as far as way forward is concerned, I think some new out-of-the-box way has to be thought through. Otherwise, if we just sit back and do whatever we have been doing in the traditional method, Danista, I think we are all set for some very, very difficult times.
Okay, fine. The one question is, there are a few questions about the debt service challenge. We are having a sovereign bond redemption coming up in a few months' time. What plans you think there is success in terms of appealing for multilateral support, Niwad?
I think the multilateral support appeal should not come from an individual country. It must come from emerging nations. It must come from developing nations. It is not a problem that is peculiar to Sri Lanka. It is a problem that is faced by the entire set of countries which are having this difficulty. Now, if by some chance these countries were to fail, the failure will not be only theirs. The failure will have serious repercussions on the advanced countries as well. So the advanced countries must realize that. The IMF must realize that. The World Bank must realize that. The G7 countries must realize that. Because if these countries fail, that will have an impact on them as well. And the whole global economic structure can be at risk. So that is why I think it needs to be looked at from a global point of view. And I feel that time has come to do that as quickly as possible. Then at the same time, I think going forward, we need to find a way in which this can be implemented. This cannot necessarily be only one country's problem. And then that's why the IMF must call up meetings where all these institutions can come in, make representations, and a very quick meeting, perhaps like what you are doing today in a webinar form or some other form that can be put in place quickly. These views must be got, and then a position paper taken forward. Because unless we do that in a collective manner, we will not be able to have this going for the future. So hopefully, we will see that taking place, and I'm confident that the world will search for a global idea to take this forward. And if we do that, I have a feeling that this will be the change that the world is looking for. That change is essential. And if that change can be put in place, we will have the new global structure that will protect all these countries, as well as the more advanced countries as well. So the debtors, the as well as the borrowers, all will be protected. Coming to the point with regard to the specific bonds, yes, Sri Lanka is having sufficient money in its reserves, international reserves, to be able to meet this bond that is maturing in October 2020. I think it's $1 billion. Sri Lanka has about $7.2 billion in reserves right now. And even if there is some erosion in the next few months, there'll be plenty remaining in order to be able to service that amount. But I think the greater challenge for the government is to collect rupees, like what Mr. Dambika Perera very rightly mentioned. There is a huge dearth of revenue. So when you have less revenue, you will find that it is not easy for the government to have sufficient rupees to be able to purchase the dollars which will be needed to settle these loans. But that's a challenge that the government will have to face. And that's why I think by that time, if the government governance structure is in place properly and with authority, the government will be able to take the necessary steps to make these things happen without too much of a concern being felt by the investor community. And we need the investor community going forward. Sri Lanka needs the investor community, not only from the fixed income groups as what we have done so far. We need to now also access the equity markets, equity funds. So if you are going to do both, we got to make sure that our confidence levels are maintained. And to do that, Sri Lanka will have to pay this bond. And I think the government has every reason to do that. And Sri Lanka has never defaulted on a single bond or any single loan in the past. And I think the government is not in a mood to start doing any default. So I'm sure they will make sure that these are met at the right time.
Okay, thank you. Dambika, there's a question for you. What is the impact on the banking sector because of the COVID impact? Have you assessed it?
No, Nista, the make a moratorium 6 months, right? I think make a risk factor at the end, company fail unoth vitarai eken the recovery karanna maru ne api hitanne
We have been rising NPLs in even before COVID. We had a rising NPL situation even before COVID.
But now the government also allowed for the 6 months moratorium.
That's right.
Then the people will have money. Even though now I think central bank also, because earlier if the people have a 5 year loan, reschedule also they put into the non-performing.
That's right. Yeah.
Because sometimes we can take the interest and no need to take the capital. Then we can give another 5 years to pay capital, right? That loan also they put into the non-performing. Because of that, if the bank was in the trouble, now they are flexible. Because of that, I think maybe the future, the people will have more flexible type of banking. I mean, only we can take the interest and the capital we can postpone. Earlier we don't have that facility. The people are in trouble, we have to push them to take the capital also. It's no point, that bank, the duty to give the money, even though they can pay 10 years or 15 years, only the variable with the interest rate, then they have no risk factor. Earlier, I will give the good example. I gave the loan for the student, right? The 1.7 million without interest for 5 years. How I gave, I asked the university to pay 40% to us, discount the package. Then I gave the money to the student and they asked us to put into the non-performing because we are not getting the money for the 5 years. That they have nothing because we are paying, the quarter payment to the university, right? And they have a 40% discount. Because of that, we have the interest part from that 40%. That is enough money for us to recover that interest for the 5 years. Only then the payment will start after 5 years. But that payment also they put into the non-performing. Because of that, after that, the bank staff, they don't want to show that kind of a thing. They stop the loan. Finally, the student will suffer. But even the same way, here, the people have problem, then they can pay the interest and the capital they can postpone. But I think now central bank understand that part. Because of that, I don't think because people have to worry to pay the capital, they can pay the interest and they can postpone the loan for the next another 5 years or whatever it is until they're comfortable. But NISTA always, they have a green companies. Mean the business is going to be a good. Then some companies going to be the ember. They will struggle a little bit. But some in industry, like the hotel for this year, they will struggle. They're in the red zone. I think the garment factories and the... But same time, NISTA oil price came down because that benefit also with us. Right? The import restriction also there because of that. Things also with us. Say we have a 3 million people working abroad. Even though 300,000 people lost the job, is only 10%. Right? Then the foreign remittance may be 7 billion. My prediction is 10%. The 300,000 people will lost the job. It's a 10%. You have to calculate the total number with the percentage. Otherwise, if you scared, say 50,000 people are coming, then foreign remittance, no. We can afford to have a job loss up to 300,000. Then the 10% is the 700 million. I think overall, the balance of payment is, last year is 1.8 billion. This year can be a 1 billion. Better than the last year.
Okay. You mean there'll be a balance of payment deficit? 1 billion, yeah, okay. Because imports will be less than also despite exports.
No, but the oil price.
Okay.
Even though the tourism sector will hit, the garments will export will less, but at the same time, the local also, the travel every year, 2.7 million people are going abroad. That money also is inside the country. It's also foreign exchange, no?
Fine. Nimad, there's a question. Whether government can consider tax relief going for a 1 year period. With all these things, there's a question about whether we can, there is fiscal space to give all so much of tax relief. And also the issue about printing money to finance some of the commitments. Can you comment, being a central bank, ex-central bank governor, there's a lot of criticism about excessive printing of money. And also the fiscal space to continue to extend the tax relief? Three questions. Other one is about this confusion on the tax reductions and revisions, which we have been talking for the last 4-5 months. That's an Indian Revenue problem. Yeah.
Yeah, I think there is very little fiscal space available. There's no doubt about that, because many businesses are struggling and many are finding it difficult to make payments. And that problem didn't occur after COVID. That problem actually started or was there for some time. But in the year 2019, although the government expected to get 2.2 trillion, they ended up getting only 1.8 trillion. Even though the percentage for taxes was high, the final result was very low tax revenue because of the fact that most of the businesses were struggling. So that situation had to be rectified. And as Dhamika quite rightly mentioned, some stimulus had to be given, and that was the stimulus that was given. That stimulus is no longer going to be a further stimulus post-COVID. So because of that, we got to have a period during which some new type of activity has to be given. So that's why I think, A, we got to now not burden the businesses anymore with further debt. The more debt you give to businesses, the bigger their struggle would be. I think they need to make sure that they are supported with some kind of a equity infusion. That's why I suggested that a venture capital kind of a companies as well as institutions are being wooed in order to get new funds to come into the country, at least 150 to 200 billion rupees, which will ensure that these businesses can be given support from the point of view of equity. Now, that is easier said than done, but there are many, many institutions in the world who specialize in debt capital, and many institutions in the world that specialize in equity capital, and another set of companies in the world, as well as investors in the world, who specialize in venture capital kind of investments. So we got to ascertain which group we are going to access and then work on those. And I am confident that if we do it right, we should be able to get those funds to come into the country so that we can support all these businesses that are struggling today. It will also mean that they will be able to pay the debts due to the banks to some extent, which means the banks also become liquid. And that would be a win-win arrangement for everyone. With regard to your point, with regard to money printing is a phenomenon that sometimes has to be resorted to by governments as well as non-central banks in order to go through difficult periods. It's like you going and getting an overdraft, Nista, in a time that you see some revenues coming in the future, but you have some difficulty right now. And in order to support your liquidity, you go and ask for some kind of a facility. So money printing, the treasury bills that the central bank issues to itself at the government's request is actually the money printing that we're talking of. Now, because I know that this is a popular question, I prepared for it as well. And I looked at the money printing during the last 5 years, or rather the last 6 years. Data is there in the central bank annual reports as well as weekly indicators. From 2014, August only. I think it should have been there from the past because I knew when I was a governor, it was there. But in August 2014, there was not a single rupee printed in excess. Zero. September was zero. October was only 2 billion. November was only 7 billion. December was only 3 billion. Then January also in 2015 was zero. 2015, February was 1 billion. Thereafter, the situation has started, 65, 68, 49, and so on. So anyone can access this and see. And the entirety of 2015, 2016, 2017, 18, and 19, we have had huge sums of money being printed in excess of what is required. And that is, those are the treasury bill holdings of the central bank. And this year in April, and now, I think it has gone up to about 300 billion, which is a big number, which needs to be now controlled at some stage or the other. But this 300 we have had in 2016 as well. In 2016, December, there was 331 billion. So I am, as a former central bank governor, as you asked me the question, I'm not alarmed by that. I'm not saying it is a life and death matter and then the whole world will collapse if you print money. Yes, at certain stages you got to print money, but you must have an idea as to when that would be settled by the government as well. Now, why we had during my period very low numbers was not that we didn't have excess printing at any time. There were instances. But at every time when the Treasury Secretary would ask me whether we could accommodate the government with excess Treasury bills, I always got a commitment of the date by which it would be settled. And we made sure that that was settled. So you can see the records of the central bank and you would find that there were instances, but there was settlement as well. It's like a good bank manager asking the client, you have taken a loan, settle it. And once you settle it, you have a relationship which is showing a greater trust. And then even if the client sometimes asks for a bigger overdraft, you might give that. But you know that the client will settle that. So here also, the government must establish a good rapport with the central bank. Well, if you take a loan, settle it. Government also must settle it. So I think that is the onus on the government. And I would think that that is essential. And hopefully between this Treasury Secretary and the current governor, there will be that kind of a relationship where the Treasury Secretary will borrow, but the central bank will make sure that the money is returned and that the greater impact that will be caused to inflation and so on is not going to be felt by the economy if that persists. So that's a challenge, Nista. And I would expect that to take place. And hopefully that would happen in the next few months.
Yeah, the consolidated fund has been on an overdraft situation for years and years. So maybe they have been overdrawn. Treasury has overdrawn and not settled. Are you aware?
I am aware of that. That's why I said I gave you the date that it really started getting aggravated from March 2015. It has been like that. But if you go through the records during the time that I was the governor, we would have had temporary instances of that going up, particularly during the time of the war. There were instances, and we had enough of a crisis. We had a global economic crisis, the banking crisis, the oil crisis, and so on. But there were instances where money printing, as it were, was resorted to. But in every instance of that nature, it was rectified. So I would expect that also to happen this time round too. And if the government and the central bank can come to an arrangement of that happening, that wouldn't alarm me too much as a result.
Okay, fine. We have the last segment of this conversation, I mean, the panel webinar. We are approaching almost 12:30. The focus is to go back to the stock market. I know just a quick response, was it sort of justifiable that the stock market was closed for 6 weeks, Nivad and Dhammika? Do you justify that decision when the bond markets were open, other markets were open?
No, Nista, because you know that people cannot see that, you know, the with the curfew, you know, the future, what is going to be, you know, from tomorrow, when they open, I think, you know, everybody is positive because they know that they can do the business, right? Because of that, from tomorrow, with the situation, I think maybe, you know, I don't know when they are going to make, but now is the time to think. But before, with the closed environment, with the curfew, then there were no prediction when the curfew going to be lifted. I don't think it's the government side decision is good. But from today, tomorrow, then you have to see. Until today, I can justify.
Yeah, now tomorrow, though it's opening up, I just saw alert saying that the health director general has said not to operate the public buses. So we have one.
I don't know. This is the reason. You have to see what is the size of the circuit break.
Yeah.
You know, what time, you know.
No, I'm talking about the confidence level coming back to resume. Nivad.
I'll respond too. Let me say this. I'm very, very happy that the market is going to open.
Okay.
Because that might tell you what I feel. I have always taken the view that markets will sometimes be challenged, but you got to let markets operate. What if we didn't have a T market? what would happen to the people who want to sell tea? What would happen to the people who want to buy tea? Even if the tea prices are up or down, the market must operate. Market has nothing to do with the prices. Market has nothing to do with the buyers and sellers alone. Market is only the marketplace, just like Manning Market or like Dambulla Market. If the Dambulla Market is there, people will come, and if they don't want to bring goods, they won't bring goods. If they want to keep the potatoes at home or their beans at home and not come to the market, that's a different issue. But the market, for it to be credible, must be open. So I am personally happy that even though late, that the market is opening, Mr. Because markets have to open. And markets can meet their own needs. And buyers and sellers will decide at what price they want to transact business. There'll be one price for whatever products, and they can go ahead. So I think markets being open is a good thing. And when you look at markets, if we do have a few time, minutes, I might just take you through a few of the tips that I would like to give investors in the market, but maybe after Dhammika has also responded. I think right now, it's a good lesson for us. Markets are institutions that only provide the space for buyers and sellers to meet. I mean, we learned that in the first lesson in our economics book. What is the market? And they will say some markets are perfect, some are not perfect. But whichever way it is, markets are important. Otherwise, you cannot transact business. So I'm happy that the market is open. But this first few days might have some challenges. But as Dhammika quite rightly mentioned, people will find their own levels. Sometimes they might think, okay, just because the market is open, that means it's a good thing. And there may be people who are willing to sell, but there may be people who are willing to buy as well. So let's see how that works. And I'm personally happy that that opportunity is there for people to once again transact business. And once they start doing that, we will see there'll be a lot of confidence coming back into the economy. And that's very, very important.
Can regulators look at some stop forced selling? Can there be some relief given for the fact that there were 6 weeks of or 7 weeks of no market closure? Can there be some financial relief given to the stakeholders, market participants? Can there be, or you feel that that's
the markets must let the markets come up and recommend something, Minister. That's important, because if the investors feel that there must be some benefit to be granted, I think there is a need for the markets themselves to develop it. That's what we call free markets. So what does the market recommend? Does the market, you see, when there is good times, the markets don't come and ask the government for anything. So when there is bad time also, markets must lock that into their overall systems. What do they want? What happened that they need some support? So whichever way it is, I think it's important for them to also play a proactive role. And let's see what they come up with. And there must be a request made for that. So I think before the government jumps the gun and says, okay, we'll give you this relief or that relief, let the market come and say, this is the relief that we would think we should have. And this is how much it will cost. This is how we want it financed. And let them come up with an idea as to what they feel is the best way to go forward. Because then we'll see the true private sector spirit coming in. Because that's what we have been always searching for.
Okay. Dhammika, I like to ask this question. I enjoy asking this question. Given the valuations, will you be looking at acquisitions, new acquisitions in the market in terms of, I mean, mergers and acquisitions? Are you, is it the right time to get in? And if you were to invest tomorrow, which sector will you invest in the stock market?
Notice that, you know, that even the micro, you know, that they have a green companies, amber companies and the red companies. You know, then first what I thought, you know, that I have 58,000 people. I think better for the next year to fine tune the my companies without going the new companies. Because, you know, I can do much better thing with the my companies because they have 58,000 people. Actually, the Thailand and the Indonesian factories is not affected for this scenario. They're not the lockdown. Because of that, actually, we have a huge capacity. I mean, the 24 hours, you know, you manufacture more than 100%. It's like 120% output from the Indonesian side. And the Indonesian, we have two factories. And the Thailand, we have three factories. The whole the 5K factories, I know the 120% kind of level. Some industries, it's a very green Nista, I will tell you. The some companies amber, but what I'm sure for the next 3 months, I can bring them also into the green. Some sector I haven't known, even though I put input, nothing I can do. Say the tourism, what I can do, nothing. They have no fine tuning part. Only the, we can do the maintenance, nice, you know, we have no time to repair. Now we are doing that part, right? Renovation, everything without anything. But for me, exactly, I'm so confident that coronavirus will go before injection come. Then the injection pain is not going to be there for Nista for you. You know, no need to put the injection, right? Before that, coronavirus will go. You know, that number, in my mind, I'm so confident. Because I know the theory behind why, you know, even the USA government, why they are waiting. Because they have a mathematical calculation for that. It's not the exactly theory, but I know what is the how to build a model. It's not an AI model. It's a mathematical, just a model with the A to B, B to C like that. Now it's come to like every 6 days, the next one is also one. Maybe after next month, first week, you will smile and wait because it's going down, because we are upset with the things are coming up. The, you know, that roller coaster will come from the next month, first week. I mean, the coronavirus, you know, you will feel it next month, first week. Then, you know, that will, you know, the number you will justify with the next month, first week, the same time, right? Because of that. Then this is the reason I told the number, the 17th Sunday, 11 o'clock, is the total patient going to be a 4.715 million. You write down, I need variation plus or minus 3%. Yep. You can see the number.
Damika, you may not be investing in the market, but if you someone were to ask your advice, which sectors would you pick as growth sectors in the next
course, normally, you know, when I'm doing deep study, then I can comment. Because normally, in the just without to what I have to tell you into my mind, I'm not going to tell you. No, is a reason even to speak, you know, some sector why people are asking me why you're not come to the public now. Because I need at least my staff 2000 hours to do study for me, then I need 400 hours to talk to 2 hours. Right? Then I need like my time also like at least 500 hours to prepare and come to that kind of a knowledge. Otherwise we cannot talk. But then I need another 200-300 hours to study the whole thing and come out. But at the moment I am stuck with the hobby, you know, but education, because I have a goal, another 1 month I need to reach 100,000 students per day. I will, you know, because next 30 days I will achieve that goal.
Okay, fine.
Lisa, if I may just add on to something for that.
Yeah.
See, while I wouldn't want to get into any arrangement or to any suggestion about any specific sectors, I want to only just mention, you see, this market is what is driving you to think which sectors to go for today. I would think what is important is not this mark-to-market arrangement where you see a value tomorrow or day after tomorrow. You have to get used to more long-term type of investments, because then you don't go wrong too much. You still might have some instance where you will go wrong, but this investing at a time when you are in turmoil really is something that you should do with a long-term focus. If you think that I will invest today and tomorrow it will come down or it will go up, then that is not the way to look at proper investments. Even in times that markets are going down, a lot of people make money because you are averaging out your cost. If you buy, if you are buying, you are most probably finding, you know, that your average is coming down further and further. And in a market that is going up, if you are selling small parts of your portfolio, you are realizing your profits. So I think what we need to understand is that the whole idea behind the stock market needs to be changed in Sri Lanka. Many people think of it as a gamble, where you go in and then you sell something and make a little profit one day. And if you lose, you look at some person to find fault with because you lost some money. You must take a long-term view and go forward on that basis. If you do that, you will find that you are taking a 4 to 5 year horizon. And you must also invest funds in the market that you know you can commit for a longer period of time. If the money that you're going to have for breakfast, but you need to pay for breakfast tomorrow, you're going to invest today, you're in trouble because you don't know how much it will realize. And there are different types of instruments for that. If you want a fixed income, you must go into the fixed income market. If you want to have a erratic income, but you might make extraordinary profits, you may go into the equity market. If you want to have super profits sometime, you might go into the venture capital market. So it all depends on what your appetite is. So I think we are mixing up appetites here. So little by little, maybe you know, you are one of the most respected editors of a newspaper which is business oriented. That kind of a philosophy must also be now enunciated within the public of Sri Lanka, that when you are investing in these different types of instruments, these are the risks, these are the returns. And this is the type of time horizon that you should look at. And if we can start doing that, I think some lesson that we have learned from COVID can then be instilled into the minds of investors as well.
Nista, that what I told, you know, my office, I am not going to acquire, but sometime the tomorrow, one of my managing director come and says, I want to buy this company. Then I have nothing to say because I have to agree with it, right? So that keep is my office, I am not looking. But sometime my managing director, one of the company's chairman, come and, you know, suddenly come to my office and tell, I want to buy this company. Then, you know, I have nothing to say. I have to say, oh, yes, right? Don't keep that part. But my office is not looking.
Yeah, okay. The head office is not looking. The head office is not looking.
Not looking, yeah.
Okay, thank you. We need to wrap it up, gentlemen. Thank you very much. I want both panelists to give your perhaps final statement as to how optimistic, how confident are you that Sri Lanka will make this opportunity, get it right in this another opportunity that is before the nation to, you know, get growth right, get smart growth right, fix other problems and all that. Niwad, I'll start with you. What's your own confidence level and how do you see it?
I have always been optimistic, enjoyed creating the future, and that is important. If we can think what our future should be, and then we work towards that, there is a much greater chance of achieving that future than if you don't have a plan. Now, I think coming out of this difficult situation, we got to also think, where do we want to go? We want to get out of this current situation, and as Dammika quite rightly mentioned, over the last 5 years, we only grew by $6 a year. And in the past, the period before that, we were growing at least by $250 a year. So $6 a year is a very low base. So that tells you, okay, that's a low base. And then now we should now search for some results that will take us forward fast. I would like to think of this new challenge in that fashion. We have a low base. We have got, of course, a very, very difficult situation to be in. First year may be tough, but beyond that, maybe something that we should be able to paint in a canvas that will make us go forward. And I would like to approach it in that fashion and then move forward with some clarity also in mind. And for that to happen, I'm very, very keen that there is an authoritative government in place. Authoritative, what I mean is that the authority of the government is clear, because if we can have that only, we can attract investors. We cannot go out to the world and say, hey, this is our policy, come and please invest with us, if we don't have a clarity as far as policies are concerned. So I think it's important for the whole country to understand that we need to have a proper government in place for us to go forward. If we have that in place, then we have the ability to go to the world and say, this is our policy, this is what we should do, and help us to do that and be a partner with us in going forward. To do that, we must have the proper building blocks in place, which is one most important thing in the election. And with that, we must have a proper economic plan. Not only the economic plan that the president has enunciated so far has to go forward, but also a recovery plan, a revival plan, which both must go together. And if we can get that in place, then we'll have an optimistic future. And I think we have every reason to believe that we can be optimistic for the future.
Okay, thank you. Dhamika?
No, Nisa, because this government, the president and the prime minister working hard, right? They're working even though Saturday, Sunday. It's not like earlier. Earlier only they work 6 hours, Saturday, Sunday off, holiday. Right? I need, you know, the leaders to work, you know, like me. Then I think any problem, you know, can sort it out. Without working, then finished, Nisa. Because of that, you know, that I know that the president and the prime minister are working. Because of that, that ability is enough to, you know, give a confidence for me. You know, that's the only main thing I'm looking, no? Is working, good. Is not working, it's bad. Right? Because of that, I don't think Nista is, you know, that for the country, this country is not the smallest. 87 billion total GDP to manage is like, you know, the small company, no? Because of that, I don't think it's going to be a big problem. You know, I think people have no need to worry also, but only think some sectors, people have a problem, but they also have to think when the COVID problem is going to be over. You know, according to that, they have to plan. But I think today the people are not going to trust the COVID going to be over another 8 months or 10 months. But next month, same day, the 10th, people will realize that will be, going to be the whole world. I'm not talking the Sri Lanka. I'm talking about the whole world. I don't think it's maybe they can, this kind of a virus can sustain more than 10 months.
Okay, fine. Thank you. Thank you very much, Nivad and Dhamika. On behalf of the SC Securities and the Daily FT, we are grateful for your time and fairly frank comments. I know it's a public forum, so thank you very much for being very bold and forthright, as well as fairly thought-provoking ideas were shared. So thank you very much for both Nimad and Dhamika. And I'd like to thank the SC Securities team for partnering with the Daily FT in carrying out this webinar with very important and popular personalities in Sri Lanka. So thank you very much. And for webinar participants, there were a lot of questions. I hope we will find some other time to raise some of these questions, but maybe SC Securities and Daily FT will see how best we can communicate some of the ideas shared in the webinar. So thank you very much and have a good day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you for SC Securities. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks.